Good evening. Welcome to the Zoning Board of Adjustment meeting for the City of Portsmouth for December the 18th, 2018, our last meeting for this calendar year. On our agenda this evening, we have one old business case, case 11-1 that we'll be reviewing, and five new business cases, case 12-1 through case 12-5. It's not a lot, but our package still end up being pretty thick, so we'll see how long that takes us to get through all that. Towards that end, just going over, as always, our rules that we have here for the board. Anyone who is presenting this evening, we give presenters a period of 15 minutes to talk to their project in front of the board. If the presenter feels that they need more than 15 minutes, we do request that you ask for that additional time prior to beginning your presentation, and the board will decide whether or not to grant the additional time. Similarly, anyone who's here this evening to speak from the public, we normally grant 5 minutes for public speaking, either to or either in favor or in opposition. If that is not enough time for you to present all the information that you want to, I will call for two for against after that point, at which point in time you may come back up and provide that additional information. We don't put a specific time limit on it at that point in time, but we do ask that you keep it germane to the consideration that we are having with the criteria, and if it's not, I might ask you to sit down. Similarly, if you are here to speak from the public this evening, just to help our notes taker out, we do have a sign up in the entryway just past that door. Either as you're coming in, or if you after you speak, if you would please put the information down, and just helps us to get our information accurate. A lot of times, names, addresses, and whatnot, stuff for our notes taker to fully know who came before us to speak, and we value your information, so we want to make sure our minutes are ultimately correct. All right, so with that being the end of the year, we'll have a new calendar year next year, and our first order of business this evening is election of officers. So I've served as your chairman now for a couple of years. You can decide whether you want me to continue or if it's time for a coup d'etat. I'm fine with either one. So if you're looking for anything, Ms. Parrott, as our most senior member, I don't know if you want to.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we open the floor to nominations for your chairman and vice chairman as well.
Okay.
Second.
Yep. Okay. Any nominations that anyone wants to have?
If no one else wants to make a motion, I'd like to move that we retain the present officers, namely Mr. Ayum and Mr. Johnson, in their roles as they've served the past year and done a fine job, and that would be my motion.
Okay, is there a second for that motion?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Last chance to bug out.
And I didn't ask Mr. Johnson if I asked you, but I didn't ask Mr. Johnson if he be willing to serve. Yeah, okay.
All right, I can tell Mr. Hageman at some point when he becomes a regular member, he's gonna wanna like chase after me. All right, in the meantime, that is the motion that's before us. So the motion would be to have myself remaining as chairman and Mr. Johnson as vice chair. I'll just go over the voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair slightly reluctantly votes aye as well. So we have it that will be your officers for 2019.
Thank you.
All right. So we do have one of our regular members who's absent this evening, Mr. Lee, and one of our alternate members is also absent, Ms. Eldridge. So we will be having Mr. Hageman sit in on all petitions this evening, and then we will have one recusal for one of our cases, in which case there will only be six voting members for that particular case. So our next item up is approval of minutes for our last meeting on November the 20th, 2018. Are there any comments or corrections to those minutes?
I had two very minor corrections.
Okay, go ahead.
On page eight in the top paragraph, second line from the bottom,
where it says, for the additional units and smaller buildings, I believe smaller should be similar. And then again on page 15, top paragraph, top line, municipality ordinance pertained should be pertaining.
Okay. Other comments? Again, I think the minutes were excellent, but I do have two small items on page 2. The large paragraph under the request for rehearing for property located at 127 and 137 High Street. That paragraph begins, Vice Chair Johnson, the second to last sentence has, says, and that the board was not approving the fact that the building would be close to the property. I would change that to neighboring property lines. So that's a quote from me. And then at the far end of the minutes on page 16, so that's the last page, at the top of the page, it just says Vice Chair moved that the special exception be granted. I just think accidentally forgot Johnson, so Vice Chair Johnson moved that the special exception be granted. It wasn't that excellent minutes overall. All right, do we have a motion on accepting those minutes?
I move to accept the minutes.
All right, is there a second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye as well. The minutes are accepted. All right, we will begin with our old business. So we will start off with case 11-1. Our old business cases, petitioners are Ryan and Karen Baker for a property located at 137 Wyberd Street. The assessor plan is map 134, lot 48 in the zoning district general residence A. The request is to create an attached single car garage. This requires a variance from section 10.521 to allow a 0-foot left yard, side yard setback where 10 feet is required, and 27% building coverage where 25% is the maximum allowed. So at our last meeting, we put this item on the table to allow the petitioner applicant to work with the planning department to try and address some of the board's concerns, in particular with the closeness of this proposed structure to the property line. Do we have a motion to take it off the table to consider at this point, based off the information provided by the applicant?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Your second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, any opposed? And the chair votes aye as well. We remove it from the table. Is there anyone here to speak this evening on the changes made to this petition? Please come forward.
Good evening. Ryan Baker. I own 137 Wyberd Street.
Okay.
Do I have a few minutes?
Yeah, please. You have 15 minutes, so just tell us what...
Be shorter than that.
What changed since the last time you were
here? Sure, sure. So good evening. First, I want to thank this board for the time that's spent on the application in November during the meeting, and also giving me the opportunity to make the requested changes and adjustments to my application. I want to acknowledge that I have heard your concerns, and specifically relating to the 0-foot side setback where 10 feet is required. Based on the previous meeting, I can see why the 0-foot setback would be a concern, because there would inevitably be an encroachment on the abutting lot, i.e. building the structure, future repair and maintenance, runoff, etc. After reading through the letter that was sent to me by this board, it outlined two options that I could consider for the rehearing. Number one was to work with the abutting neighbor to figure out an easement to keep the garage at a 0-foot setback. Number two would be to redesign the garage to help increase the setback that would help alleviate the board's concerns about this application. After speaking with my lawyer, I have decided not to pursue the easement option because of the overall costs and the simple fact that I agree with the board that 0-foot setback is just too close. I decided to revisit my garage design and increase the setback to 2.5 feet and move the garage about 10 feet back away from Wyberd Street. Because the abutting property is a rental, I have still not been able to meet the owner and just don't feel comfortable asking someone that I don't know for an easement, hence the reason for me choosing number two. Based on conversations with my builder, this is the largest side setback I can have while still having a usable garage at 10 feet wide. My builder has informed me that this setback will provide enough room to permit construction and future repair and maintenance without encroaching on the neighboring lot. Furthermore, the garage has been designed to minimize any effects on the abutting property, including the roof line and drainage. By submitting this variance application, the intention was never to affect someone else's property, only to provide some relief with my own lot. I believe that by increasing my side setback, it is better for everyone involved and certainly less intrusive. I also want to address the previous comments regarding my property and the fact that it was subdivided a few years ago. As mentioned, I am in a difficult position to respond to that specific concern, as I can only deal with the situation as it exists today and not the prior owners or boards, what boards have may have decided. In short, this variance request is not necessitated by a self-created hardship, and I respectfully request the board to review our property as it exists today, not how it once existed or based on what previous owners may have sought from this board. Lastly, and as outlined during the previous meeting, this application does check all the boxes when it comes to the five categories related to granting a variance. The special conditions of our property necessitate the driveway to be located where it is, along the property line with our neighbor, which dictates the location of the proposed garage and the need to construct it within the 10-foot side setback. A garage is a reasonable use consistent with other properties in the area and will constitute minimal intrusion into the side setback. As discussed on Wybird Street, the vast majority of houses and garages are close to the property line. Some, like one of my neighbors on the other side, is actually over the property line. And this project would not diminish the surrounding home values, only enhance them. You also noticed at the last meeting that no one came to speak out against this project. Once again, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to revise this application. I have heard your concerns and followed your suggestions outlined in your letter to increase the side setback from 0 to 2.5 feet. I believe that by increasing the setback, it strengthens this application and will not have any effect on the abutting property. I appreciate your guidance on this project and remain hopeful that we can move forward with these revised plans. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Questions for the applicant? All right, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Mr. Adico, I'm sorry.
I didn't see your
I didn't want to be the first again. just a couple. Is the dormer mostly aesthetic, or is it a usable space? What would it be used for?
It's aesthetic because the house as it currently sits has a large dormer on the top. And previously we built a house on the corner of Sagamore and Jones. We had a house on Sagamore and Jones, and we built a garage there. And I think it looks better when you have it matching. So we tried to copy that same look.
And I can appreciate that you redesigned the garage to have that 2.5 foot offset from the line. Mm-hmm. Is the sketch here to scale, or is it just this is a placeholder so you can sort of imagine it?
It's a placeholder. I mean, the nice thing is that when we bought the lot, because it was subdivided in the past, all the stakes are there. It's very well defined. It was actually surveyed recently in the last couple of years. So, you know, a lot of houses in Portsmouth, you can't find any of this stuff, right? So I know exactly where the line is. And to be totally honest, the front left corner, if you're looking at the garage, is 2.5 feet. And the property line actually starts to move back a little bit. So as you move further away into the garage, it actually gets a little bit larger to closer to 3 feet. But I just wanted to make sure you guys knew that that would be the minimum in the front corner.
Thank you.
So you do believe you know exactly where that property line
yes,
is from a survey point?
I can see it, right, clear as day. And there's actually a fence on the property line that's actually just a little hair on my side. It's not quite on the property line, but I know exactly where the line is.
Okay. Other questions? All right, thank you very much. Okay, we appreciate you coming back before us.
Yep.
I will open up the public hearing. Is there anyone here to wish?
Yeah. I think you held the public. I think you would need to vote to reopen.
Okay.
Because you held the public hearing.
Sure.
If the board wants to reopen it.
Okay. Nope. Good reminder. So what are our thoughts? Do we want to reopen up the public hearing, give anyone else a chance to speak to the revised application?
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Okay.
Make that motion.
All right. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All right. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? And chair votes aye as well. All right. We'll reopen public hearing on this item. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Anyone to speak to, for, or against? All right, seeing no one rise, we will close the second public hearing. Okay, Board, we have the revised petition in front of us. I will open up for thoughts. We do have information from the Planning Department. I don't know if, Peter, you want to talk a little bit about your bolded statement that you have here at the bottom of the Planning Department.
In recent past, when, you know, homeowners come before us without a survey, often, or we've had a couple of instances where they've had to come back because once they get the as-built survey for the foundation, they realize that it's closer, sometimes maybe a half a foot. So it's just adding this, and you'll see this throughout the staff report for those applications that are, you know, just from homeowners that have had a sketch and not a surveyed plan, that you might want to consider that plus or minus distance, whether it's a couple inches or however, whatever the board determines. You could add that as a condition of approval, that if it's within 2 inches, that's okay. To account for that plus minus that we advertised for. Just a consideration. That just to prevent someone from having to come back if once they get the as-built, they're end up being closer. This case might be different since the survey was recently done and he says he actually knows where the line is, but right. It might be something you want to consider.
Okay. So just something to keep in mind as we move forward here. Otherwise than that, I'll open up discussion or anyone want to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I would move approval as presented with a stipulation that with respect to the comments Mr. Sith just made, excuse me, that we put an allowance in. This might save some folks from going for an equitable waiver for a few inches or a revised variance or whatever the mechanism might be. And I would suggest in this case that the distance for no particular reason be the wiggle room, however you want to phrase it, would be my 6 inches, say.
Okay.
That would be my motion.
All right. Is there a second for that motion? Second. All right. Your motion, please, Mr. Parrott.
Thank you. This is a case of where we have a very simple situation. Personally, just speaking for myself, the only concern I had with the initial proposal was this side setback, which is virtually the only thing that's of much concern here anyway. So with respect to the first two criteria, granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest, and granting the variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance. As usual, there are no compelling public interest that I can see would be in danger with respect to this property. It's a modest proposal on a well-established neighborhood where there are many similar situations where many of the houses and garages and other buildings are fairly close to the property lines. So I see no harm possible, and that it would not in any way endanger public health, safety, or any of those other factors that we're concerned about. Granting the variance would do substantial justice. In this case, there's a clear benefit to the homeowner with a property of this type and a home of this type. It's certainly more than reasonable to have a garage, and it's a modest garage. It's not requested overbuild for the lot, and it's in a logical location. Excuse me. And fourthly, granting the variance would not diminish the value of surrounding properties. Again, this will be situated such that it will blend right into the neighborhood. It'll look like a very logical part of this property. Will not stand out as something odd where it's from its design or from where it's situated on the lot with respect to the house and with respect to other properties as well. And as far as unnecessary hardship tests, the property is a fairly large building, on a fairly small lot. And this is about the only logical place a new garage could be situated on the property, and work for the benefit of the homeowner. And as I indicated before, it'll look as though it belongs, and therefore will have a beneficial effect on this property and by extension probably on the surrounding ones as well. So I think it meets all the criteria.
Okay, thank you. Your second, please.
I have nothing further to add to Mr. Parrott's discussion on the criteria, and just I thank the applicant for hearing our concerns at the last meeting and coming back, and I do think that it's a better application because of it.
Okay, thank you. All right, comments from any board members on the motion? All right, I'll just say I will be supporting the motion, although part of me wants to be somewhat Grinch-like in the fact that I am still somewhat concerned that, you know, we did subdivide this lot with the idea and was presented before us that, hey, this is a perfectly livable house, that there's nothing needed additional, that will ever require additional action from this board. Obviously, this is a new homeowner. We understand that, you know, you weren't part of that process. And I do think that you did hear the board's concerns, are willing to move the garage back. It is a very modest structure overall, pretty small. If it was much larger, I think I would have more heartburn with it. But because of its modest size, and I think there's a pretty good argument that there are some other structures in the neighborhood that are, garage structures that are very close to property lines, I think I'm willing in this particular case to be more Santa Claus than Grinch for this one. So with that, I will be supporting it. Any other final comments? All right, with that, we'll move to a vote. The motion is to approve with a stipulation that the side distance be no less than 2 feet, which is a 6-inch difference from what has been presented by the applicant. Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
Mr. Formella?
Yes.
Mr. Hageman?
Yes.
And the chair also votes yes, you are approved. All right. We will now go into new business. Our first new business case is case 12-1. Petitioners are John R. and Karen E. Allard for a property located at 24 Burkett Street. The assessor plan is map 160, lot 23, in the zoning district General Residence A. The request is to replace an existing porch with a 10-foot by 22-foot enclosed porch. This requires a variance from section 10.521 to allow a 5-foot left side yard where 10 feet is required, and a variance from section 10.321 to allow a non-conforming building or structure to be extended, reconstructed, or enlarged without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance. Who is here to speak on behalf of this petition?
It's me, John Allard. My wife, Karen, right here, if I need any support.
Okay. Apparently only moral support at this point.
Yeah. I want to thank the board for, hearing this tonight. I suppose you folks run into a lot of people that haven't done this before. I'd be one of them, so expect a lot of ums and ahs and stuff like that. So we bought this house this summer as a retirement house. I recently retired, at least from the job that I held for 38 years, and we spent a lot of time in Portsmouth because we kept a boat in the harbor about more than 25 years ago for about 10 years, and always wanted to come back here, and it was always our dream. We raised our two children, and we moved to Portsmouth, and we found a great neighborhood and a great house. Our insurance company kind of threw us a little curveball, and it was always our intent to do something with this porch. But the existing porch is 6x10, and it has a rotted corner on it. It was disclosed, it was part of the, we were aware of it. So it was our intention to do something with it. But the insurance company threw us a curveball and gave us a deadline to make a repair to this porch, or they were going to drop us. And this is an agent we've had for 35 years. So that really caught us by surprise. We told them our intention was not to repair it, but to replace it. We engaged a builder that had done work in the neighborhood. I got a recommendation from my neighbor right across the street, and I wanted to use this guy because he came, recommended by that. He's done work in the neighborhood. We decided that we'd like to make the, we need to replace the porch. It's got a rotted corner. The support is okay under it, but that's all going to be removed. The inside of the porch is, it's a 6x10. It's not really usable, and it's, this rot has kind of affected the inside too. It's got an odor to it and all that. So right now, that existing porch is only 8 feet from the left set along with the house. The house and the porch is, you know, even, and it's only 8 feet from the side. We'd like to put remove that porch and put a new porch in, enclosed porch, that is 4 feet larger by the width of the house. So that would be 10x22. And what we're asking for is a little less on the setback, because we need to put the stairs out the side rather than out the back. And the reason for that is aesthetics. We want to put windows all the way across the back of the porch that faces our backyard. And I also have a granite patio that I put in, granite cobble patio that I put in, the stairs going out back would interfere with that. So we want to, the new porch, enclosed porch, would be at the same dimension as the old one to the lot line, with the exception that we want to put a landing and a set of stairs on the side, so that would reduce it to 5 feet. That side setback neighbor, we've talked to all the neighbors about this, and nobody had an objection, at least verbally talking to us. But we did get and it should be in your packets there, a letter from the left side neighbor that said they were okay with whatever we want to do. You know, we've made a bunch of improvements to the house already, and they're comfortable with, you know, they can see us just improving it more as we spend time there. We got to put the stairs on that side because there's a door that exits a kitchen that's on that side. Also, on the right side, where there's plenty of setback, we're moving the bulkhead over there. Currently, the bulkhead comes out of, it would be out under the porch. So we're moving the bulkhead to the right side. So that's, has no setback issues or anything, but just to be, so you guys are aware of what the whole porch is. It'll be on, you know, columns. It's not going to have a foundation under it. It's going to be on columns. And that's what it's about, I guess.
Okay. You included some information about the criteria that we'll be judging your application by. Did you want to provide any additional information on that, or did you want to just go with what you provided?
Yeah, that's the letter that Karen's the wordsmith. She took care of that letter for us. We didn't get any other advice from anyone, although I did get help from PETA just to make sure I had the correct paperwork in.
Sure.
So and I mentioned get to it, this point.
Only because that is what we will ultimately judge your application by, so I just want to make sure that you're comfortable with the information that you provided to us.
Yep.
Okay. All right. There's nothing further. Any questions for the applicant? All right. I don't have any. Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
Okay.
I'll open up the public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of this petition? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Anyone who wishes to speak to, for, or against? All right, seeing no one rise, so we'll close the public hearing. I have a request for a porch and some stairs going off to one side.
Dave, I'd move to approve as presented and advertised.
Okay, is there a second for that?
I'll second.
Okay.
All right, so, you know, I think this is pretty straightforward. The applicant's proposing to essentially maintain the existing setback with an expanded porch, but it will just extend from the setback that exists on the main house where the existing porch already is. I think the applicant's demonstrated that the existing porch is deficient for a lot of reasons. It's really too small to be useful, and it appears to be fairly dilapidated. So making an improvement to it is, I think, a good idea. And while he's at it, there's really no reason not to expand it the way he's doing. And the only, you know, the thing that's driving the relief and increasing the encroachment is placing the landing and the stairs into that side setback. And I think there's a good reason to do that. If the applicant were to push that out into the back, that would eat up some of the usable space in the backyard. And it appears now that there's a pretty nice usable piece of green space in backyard that the family can enjoy. So I'll just hit the criteria. Granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest, nor would it be contrary to the spirit of the ordinance. The essential residential character of the neighborhood isn't implicated at all by what's being proposed here, nor is there going to be any threat to the health, safety, and welfare of the public. Granting the variance results in substantial justice. The here, for the reasons I just stated, I think the loss to the applicant, were we to require strict compliance with the side yard setback, far outweighs any gain to the public. The home as it exists already violates the setback. This is just an incremental increase in that, and it's really done for a good reason. Granting the variance will not diminish values of the surrounding properties. As the applicant stated, the most affected neighbor is in favor of the project, and this will result in new construction, which will enhance values in the neighborhood. Finally, literal enforcement of the ordinance results in an unnecessary hardship. As we've discussed, the side yard setback is already non-conforming, so that's a special condition of the property that distinguishes it from others. There's no fair and substantial relationship between the side yard setback and its specific application of this property. Again, what the applicant is proposing to do is simply replace the existing deficient porch with a more modern, larger one, and create a better access point for it. So there's a little additional encroachment, but to me it's not significant. Certainly, I think hardship is met. It's a reasonable use. It's a residential use in a residential zone, so it meets all the criteria.
Okay, thank you. Your second, please.
I didn't have anything to add except to note that the planning department had the same comment that we had on the last application. I don't know if it makes sense to give a little.
Yeah, and that's up to you, the two of you as motion makers, or if you want to hold them to the 5 feet and they. I mean, they're going
to leave it up to.
Unfortunately, the stairs are probably going to need to be per code, so.
Yeah, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Is there a reason that that language is on there? Because I'm just curious on the stairs being built to code.
Well, sort of because he'll have to comply with the building code for egress. So it'll probably have to be 3x3 at a minimum,
right,
for a landing. Okay. So, and that's what it looks like he's proposing.
Yep. I was just curious.
So that drove that. Peter, just as a point of clarification, in your opinion, would an appropriate stipulation be that the relief granted be the minimum necessary for the landing and the stairs to meet that code?
Yes.
Okay.
That was a suggestion.
Okay. Then I would
amend your motion.
I would amend my motion to include that stipulation, if that's okay with Peter.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay.
I didn't have anything else.
Okay. Nothing else. All right. Any comments on the motion from any board members? All right. So the motion is to approve with the stipulation that that there is some variation, if necessary, to meet minimum code requirements for the stairs is acceptable. With that, I'll take a vote. Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
Mr. Formella?
Yes.
Mr. Hageman?
Yes.
And the chair also votes yes. You are approved.
Thank you.
See, that wasn't so bad, was it?
Yeah.
It can be tougher. We've been tougher on others, but. And we'll see where the rest of the evening goes. All right. All right, next up we have case 12-2. Petitioners are Jason R. and Natasha A. Carlin for property located at 88 Lincoln Avenue. The assessor plan is map 113, lot 2 in the zoning district, general residence A. The description is to replace an existing garage with an attached garage and two-story addition. This requires a variance from section 10.521 to allow a 3-foot 7-inch rear yard where 20 feet is required. and 35% building coverage, where 25% is the maximum allowed, as well as a variance from section 10.321 to allow a non-conforming building or structure to be extended, reconstructed, or enlarged without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance. Who is here to speak on behalf of this petition?
I am Jason Carlene, the petitioner.
Okay. You have 15 minutes, so tell us about the project. And
also a rookie, so please bear with me.
Okay.
Thank you, board, for your time. I do appreciate it coming out on a evening to attend the city business. We're hoping to enlarge our modestly sized house so that we can have entertaining and family and host gatherings and live a lifestyle where we're not stepping on top of each other. And we'd like to have some wintertime events because we're presently only doing them in the summer, so we can have them outside. The garage, or the proposed addition and renovation project, leverages our existing footprint and maximizes our livable volume in a way that we think is in keeping with the character of the neighborhood. It has four primary elements on the existing house, providing a dormer on the McNabb court side, which will allow us to go up into our attic level without having to duck our head into the eaves, and create some headroom to install a master bathroom. We're hoping to turn the attic into our master suite. Second element is to raise the roof over the southern portion of the existing house. That allows for a larger bedroom on the second level. In fact, the addition also adds a bedroom. Our present bedrooms are pretty small. And it allows the roof lines between the addition and the renovation portion to progress in a logical fashion and make a good connection. The third element is the demolishing the existing garage, reconstructing a new garage on the footprint, and then the fourth element is the addition between the existing detached garage and the house, and also expanding over and enlarging the present deck area to the east of the house. Our existing lot, one of the reasons it brings me before the board, is that the existing lot and structures are non-conforming and that they really encroach on the sideline, on the secondary front yard side, which is the McNabb court side on the west, and the rear yard setback on the south. But that's also the advantage of our lot, because it has a very, for the neighborhood especially, a very large open left side yard, as viewed from Lincoln. And the addition fits in there nicely and doesn't look wedged in. There will still be plenty of open space at the end of it, assuming we get permission to proceed. And we've spoken to our neighbors. I hope that late addition got into your packages, and we've received written endorsements from our three direct abutters. And I've spoken to many of the other folks in our neighborhood and shown them the plans, and everyone expressed enthusiasm for the project. We have great neighbors. We love our neighborhood. We hope to be allowed to expand our house and continue living there. Any questions?
Okay. Do you want to talk at all to the criteria that we'll be judging your application by? You don't have to.
Repeat it, but I don't want to waste your time.
Okay.
Because
that's fine. I just want to make sure that you're comfortable with that. Questions for the applicant? Any board members? I just have a couple. One is, you did mention that your neighbors were in support. However, one of them, with the package that we have here, the neighbor at 43 McNabb Court, did have one concern about some glazing. I just wanted to make sure, is that something that in your application has been addressed? They indicated
that was not part of the original application, but we met with them when reviewing the project with them.
Yeah.
And they had a concern about, you know, feeling that we were a little too close, and we agreed that frosted glass was agreeable to us both.
Okay. So your intent is to use frosted glass for that particular,
for that south-facing window on the second floor level? Yes.
Okay.
And they did not care about the window into the garage because it's unoccupied for the most part.
Okay. I actually have a question for you, Peter. Is so on the primary front yard, in the staff report, you have 15 feet minimum as the permitted required, but really it's actually like 9 feet, right, is what they're showing in their plan on like 1 of 8 and 2 of 8. They show 9 feet as the front yard setback due to the exception as allowed per 10.516.10 the front front yard alignments. I just want to make sure you're in agreement with that number.
Right, with taking the averages of the houses within 200 feet, it
right.
comes up to 9 feet.
Okay, so normally it'd be 15 feet. Their current house is at 12, 9-ish. However, because of the 9 feet is the actual requirement here.
Right.
Okay. And then similarly for the secondary front yard setback, again, you have the 15-foot minimum, but in reality, it's with a couple houses behind them, it's something less than that, probably a lot less than that, right? Not quite zero, but looks like both those houses are fairly close to the
property line.
McNabb Court, right? So their garage footprint is probably, again, the drawings don't indicate it, but the garage footprint that's being added on here is all further back than what that reduced property line
correct.
Requirement would be. Okay.
They're going to be 11 feet, 7 inches.
All right.
The garage.
And then I do have one other question for you is the garage is, are you reusing like any of the existing slab or anything as part of this garage, or are you starting over?
Starting over.
Okay. And when you looked at it, I mean, I understand that 3 feet, 7 inches is what the current garage is at, but did you look at any possibility of you know, giving a little bit more relief to the back property line? Because it is 20 feet. Is the requirement you're asking for 3 feet, 7 inches. That's a pretty substantial reduction. I'm just looking, was there any thought on, can you move the garage closer to the main part of the house? What's preventing you from doing that? What would be the implications of doing that?
There are two drivers. One is, well, three. One is it's not encroaching any more than the existing.
Yeah.
Number two is we'd like to get a second parking, you know, a second garage space if at all possible. And then also the main driver for this project is to get more living area. And if we shrink the garage, the living room that's in the attic of the garage would also get smaller.
Okay. What is the current square footage of your house? Roughly, do you know?
I think I included that in there.
Like a living space? That's coverage. Is that coverage or is that
1947? Is that?
That's the number I was going to cite. Yes.
Okay. All right.
And that's gross. There's a lot of that that's eaten up in attic and eave and unusable.
Okay. Thank you. Any other final questions? All right. Thank you. I'll open up the public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of this petition? Anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Anyone to speak to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. Quiet crowd tonight. So far. All right, board. We have a request for some relief here for a couple of additions. Any thoughts or perhaps a motion?
I would just say I had the same concern you did about, you know, they're using the same existing footprint for the garage, but if you're getting rid of that slab altogether, it seems like an opportunity to improve that setback as opposed to leaving it where it is.
Right.
And they've already got a pretty nice setback on the other side of the yard, and I would think you could bump out that addition that direction and tuck the garage in a little more, but I'm not the expert on that matter, but that was certainly a concern of mine. When looking at the build out.
Okay. Other thoughts? Anything from our last remaining architect?
I don't personally have a problem keeping the same setback. I mean, it is a vertical expansion as well, so I think it does become more imposing. But I do think it's a unique lot because it's on the corner. It's sort of a front of that. It really doesn't act as the rear lot line. It really acts more as a side yard, in a way, to me, from one perspective. So I think it's quite a big expansion, but generally the amount of relief being requested is, you know, it's a existing setback that we're being asked to approve, and is it coverage?
Coverage.
Coverage, but I mean, I think the sense I get about the site is because everything on the site is so shifted so far to one side that you don't, as the applicant, I think, made the case, you know, you still have quite a bit of open space there to sort of combat that extra building coverage. So I would have no problem approving or making a motion.
Okay. Other thoughts? I'll just say, I mean, I also think, you know, my concern is it is, I wouldn't call this the biggest addition I've ever seen, but it's decent size, especially relative to the existing size of the property. Again, most of it, other than the, you know, total coverage, is not like a setback issue because of, against the unique placement of the home on the lot. Who came up with that idea back in the 1900, circa 1900? I'm not sure, but I guess I would like to see an improvement in the rear setback, but I do think you make a pretty good argument that it is sort of a closer to a side setback, which would only be a 10-foot requirement as opposed to a 20-foot requirement. So that makes you feel somewhat better about it. Is it worth forcing the applicant to go back and, you know, rework a bunch of their plans, maybe get rid of this sort of a hallway area in between the garage and the main addition? I'm not sure if it's worth all that. It does sound like it has the support of the neighbors. I don't think we're going too far out of the box with it, so I can be in support of it as it's presented. So with that, anyone want to make a motion?
I'll move to approve.
Okay. Is there a second?
No, I'll second.
Okay. Your motion, please.
Okay. So I agree with some of the concerns that were raised. I think the thing for me is that one of the drivers of the project, I think the main driver of the project is to get more living space, which I can understand. One of the ones that was articulated, though, is to get a two-car garage, and it doesn't look like the two-car garage is going to fit in that space without getting pretty close to that existing rear yard setback. And then, as Jeremiah said, it's a corner lot, and effectively, at least with respect to the neighbor probably, the neighbor that it's affecting, thinks of it as a side setback. So I think those are reasonable. So I'll just go through the criteria. One and two, the variance is not contrary to the public interest and the spirit of the ordinance is observed. This is a big addition, but I don't think it's gonna be so big that it's gonna alter the essential character of the neighborhood. And I certainly don't see any threat to health, safety, or welfare. The third one is that substantial justice is done. And here we look at the benefit to the applicant and weigh that against harm to the general public or to other individuals. I don't think there really is any harm to the general public here, and there's a clear and very obvious benefit to the applicant. They've got, you know, a fairly decent sized house right now, but they want a bigger house with some more living space, and that's a reasonable use of their property. So clearly the benefit to the applicant outweighs any harm that I can see, at least. Four, the values of surrounding properties are not diminished. We haven't heard anything that says that they will be diminished. I don't see anything from the presentation or anything else I've reviewed that gives me the impression that they would be. And last, literal enforcement of the ordinance would result in unnecessary hardship. Here we have to look at what special conditions are on this property that distinguish it from other ones. And I think there are a couple. One, it's the corner lot, and so, as I mentioned, the, you know, what is technically a rear yard setback is in a lot of ways more like a side yard setback, and so the relief that would be being requested is if we were talking about a side yard setback, would be much more minimal. The other special condition, I think, is the siting of the existing building on the property. The applicant, I think, has done a really good job of moving most of the mass of the addition toward the center of the property. So for the size of the requested, for the size of the planned addition, the requested relief has really been pretty minimal. So those are the special conditions, and I don't see any fair and substantial relationship between the purposes of the ordinance with the setback requirement and the building coverage requirements and the specific application of those provisions to this property. And last, the proposed use is a reasonable one, and I think that goes without saying here. They're trying to add on to their existing house. So that's all.
Okay, thank you. Your second, please.
I agree with all of Mr. McDonald's comments, and the lot is only 5,000 square feet. So in order to get this additional space and garage that they want to make the house more usable for them and future people, this is a decent design, I think. And the proposed garage is modest. It's about as small as you can get, I would judge, to make a double garage 16 by 20. So for all those reasons, I think I can support the motion.
Okay, thank you. Comments from any board members on the motion? All right, with that, we'll move to vote. The motion is to approve. Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
Mr. Fermella?
Yes.
Mr. Hageman?
Yes.
And the chair also votes yes, you are approved. Okay. Next up, we have case 12-3. Petitioners are Jennifer and Dylan Thomas. Property located at 279 Wybird Street. Assessor plan is map 133, lot 35 in the zoning district, general residence A. The request is a variance from section 10. Excuse me, the description is to construct a mudroom and garage with a second floor living space. This requires a variance from section 10.521 to allow a 5-foot, 3-inch right side yard where 10 feet is required and 26% building coverage where 25% is the maximum allowed. Also requires a variance from section 10.321 to allow a non-conforming building or structure to be extended, reconstructed, or enlarged without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance. Who is here to speak on behalf of the petition?
Good evening. My name is Monica Kaiser from Hopeful Phoenix, Gormley and Roberts. I'm here for Jennifer and Dylan Thomas. With me is Dennis Morrell for technical support. We have here essentially a very similar plan to what you have up on the screen. We sent you a supplement on Monday, and it does not look like the supplemental plan is what's up on the screen, but I'm assuming, excuse me, that you have it in your packet.
Yeah, the board members were both sent it via email, and I printed it out. But additionally, at our places tonight was the supplemental information.
Okay, great. So that's the plan that I'll be talking to you about, and that's the plan that I have right here. Essentially, what we have is a lot size of 7,400 square feet, where 7,500 feet is required. We're looking to the house itself. You'll have, I think there's one picture in your packet. I have additional pictures available if you, if it comes up. This is a house that has not received any attention in quite some time. So Jennifer and Dylan have come in, they've purchased the house, and they're looking to make some substantial renovations to it inside and out. What we have currently is we have a front setback of 4.4 feet to the stairs and 5.8 feet to the front porch. And we have a 3.4 feet right setback to that side porch and a 7.4 right side setback to the house. The addition that they're gonna do is they're gonna add this garage and mudroom area here onto the back of the house. What that's going to entail with that addition, as well as the related site improvements, is they have to relocate a bulkhead around.
I just need you to be careful to keep speaking in the microphone so you can kind of, you can also use the mobile one, right?
Okay.
That one right
just there. Try to sit over here. How about that? So they're going to have to relocate the existing bulkhead, which is around on the other side of the house. They're going to need to relocate that to the right side. They're going to put some air conditioning units on the right side. Those are in your revised plan that you received on Monday. And then they're going to add this garage onto the back. Now, The porch and the mudroom area is largely compliant, but the garage is what is really going to take us into the right setback a little bit more. However, the overall improvement is going to improve for a couple of different reasons. I'm sorry, the overall result is going to improve. So there is a significant wraparound side porch that is going to be removed. So where there is currently a 3.4-foot setback on the right side of the house, that's now going to be improved because that porch is going to be removed. The garage, which is the substantial addition going on to the back of the house, is going to have a 5-foot-3-inch setback. So not as bad as 3.4, but certainly it's an addition, and it is more than what's currently there. A couple of the small things, the setback to the air conditioner unit is going to be 6.2 feet, and the setback to the bulkhead is going to be 6.5 feet. So those are that's the relief that we're asking for, and you'll find that updated in the revised relief chart that you got at your seat tonight and that you received by email on Monday. The next request is related to building coverage. When we first submitted, there had been an error in an earlier plan. So the building coverage calculation that we had initially run was not accurate, and we ended up being a little bit over 25% with the air conditioning units. And frankly, we're not sure the air conditioning units are going to count because they're smaller. But we include them in what we request tonight, which is 25.9, and we're noticed for 26% building coverage where 25 is required. That again is a result of the addition of the garage, as well as counting things like the bulkhead and the air conditioning units and the side porch. Any questions about the details of the plans?
I'll just have you finish your presentation. And then
we'll okay, I'm sorry.
Questions we might have.
So the way this house is laid out on the site, where it's closer to the right side generally, really gives us some limitations in terms of how we configure the garage. So you've got the long driveway on the one side of the house, and then you really need to place the garage in such a manner that you have enough turning radius to get in and to get out. Also, the reason the garage is where it is so that we can link up to the existing living space above in a way that makes sense for the interior layout. So to go through the criteria, when we look at the first two prongs of the variance criteria, we're looking to see that the requested variances are not contrary to the public interest and that the spirit of the ordinance is met. So taking those two factors together pursuant to the Malachy Glen case, we're considering, and we want to make sure that the variance requested do not too unruly and to a marked degree conflict with the zoning ordinance such that it undermines the basic objectives of the ordinance. Here we have a single family home in a general residence A district, where moderate to high densities are permitted, and I don't mean to say permitted technically, but that is the goal of the area. We're increasing into the setback in the back of the house, where it's 7.4, we're now going to 5.3, but we're removing that side porch in the front, and so we're eliminating a greater encroaching setback in the front. And we're also improving the front setback by removing that large porch. The overall use is still going to be a residential, still going to be single family. There's not going to be any threat to public safety, health, or welfare as a result of these variances requested. There's also not a change. This change is not in any way altering the essential character of the locality. There's several other projects in the area in the last few years where people have put on additions, they've added garages and other things. Many of the houses in this area are situated on the lot in such a way that there is encroaching into the setback. That's in part because of the way the houses are placed and in part because some of the lot lines are sort of on an angle to the street. It's not a straight rectangle. The next criteria is, of course, it not diminish the surrounding property values. We think arguably this overall project is going to increase property values significantly as this current house hasn't gotten attention for some time. Denial of the variance will result in unnecessary hardship. When we look at hardship, we're considering first whether there are special conditions of this property. Ultimately, we think the lot size itself is just under the required 7,500 square feet. It is still a significantly ample sized lot, but it does have 50 feet of frontage. It is a sort of a narrow lot considering the size of the house that's on it. And the house is located just on one side and encroaching into that right side setback. For those reasons, we think that the special conditions exist, and that's outlined in our memorandum. No fair and substantial relationship to the overall purposes of the ordinance. When we consider why setbacks exist, they exist to prevent overcrowding, to improve and maintain sight lines, to ensure adequate air and light, and adequate stormwater treatment. What we're seeking to propose here, we have a significant amount of open space area maintained. We're over 40% open space, where the minimum required is 30. We're looking for relief to the side setback in the back of the lot, not in the front of the lot, where it's going to impact the sight lines for pedestrians and motorists. The significant open space maintained around the backyard, which is still, there's going to be 64 feet from the rear lot line to the garage. So there's not going to be a substantial impact to the people behind us from the result of the addition. The people on the side have a substantial addition next to them in the way of the garage, but the encroachment is not significant over what exists. There's also a significant tree buffer to about halfway down the lot, and then a 6-foot stockade fence throughout the rest of the lot. The proposed use is reasonable. Obviously, we have a residential use in a residential zone. That's presumed to be reasonable under the case law in your packet. Finally, substantial justice is done by granting the variance. We don't see that there's any gain to the public from denial. This is a modest home existing that hasn't received any attention. We have a new family coming in, purchasing it, and they want to add a garage and some living space that's more workable for them. Living space above the garage by way of a master bedroom and an office over the garage, mudroom, and small porch in the back. For these reasons, we think the request is reasonable and should be approved. Do you have any questions?
Okay. Questions for the applicant's representative, Mr. Mulligan.
Can you explain the applicant's thinking behind removing the existing wraparound porch? Was that simply to get enough or to give you enough wiggle room for lot coverage given the pretty intense addition you're proposing?
Well, I think that's part of the driver. Also, when you look at the side porch, it's somewhat dilapidated. I'll just bring you a packet.
I need to have you speaking, so you can drop that off.
Thank you.
Okay, you can just start with Mr. Hageman and you can pass them on.
I'll pass them.
Yeah, he'll take care of it.
I'll pass them out for you.
Oh.
Yeah.
Thanks.
We're used to it.
You can do this.
You can see when you look at the first page, which is where you'll get a view of the front porch, there's a lot of light that is blocked from coming into the front room by virtue of that porch and the big tree there. So I think historically it's just not a front porch that has gotten a lot of use. And the way it wraps around the side, I don't even know if there's stairs off the back. So it's not even like you can use it to walk off into the backyard. There's some additional areas in your packet, too, where you can see the sight lines down either side of the house. There's that, those tree plantings there that also block the light to the side porch as well. So it just doesn't, it's just not really workable as a porch. It's not something that you really want to sit on and enjoy. There is an advantage also in terms of coverage and removing it, given what we're adding. But also, they have all that open space in the backyard. That's where they're going to be enjoying the space more than on the front porch. They are putting a little side porch in the back, but that's not really going to be a sitting porch.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it occurred to me that I tend to think a porch is a really nice amenity. I wish I had one, and it's not often you see people, get rid of them if they don't have to. But I think you make a good case for why it's really not very useful. So that's fair enough. Thanks.
Okay. Anything else?
Nope.
All right, Mr. Hageman.
I just was curious. I know the current living space is a little over 2,100 square feet. What is the build-out adding to it? What's the new livable square footage going to be?
That should be...
I might have missed it.
Yeah, that should be on your plan. I think it's over 3,000 square feet.
What's the number?
I think it's 3,450 total heated is what it shows up as on your plan.
Thank you.
Okay. Other questions? All right, I'm trying to understand the positioning of the garage. So you have I understand that you're taking down the porch, which is essentially improving the nominal setback, although I think a one-story open porch structure has less of an impact on light and air than maybe what's being proposed here for the garage. So I'm presuming that the location of the garage is kind of being driven by the need for turning radius and this relatively narrow lot to be able to get a vehicle to be able to back out and get down the asphalt driveway. Is that what's driving it?
That's correct. Mm-hmm. And actually, when you look at the pictures that I handed out, you actually have a view down the driveway that really makes it's more apparent when you look at the pictures. If you think of yourself driving down that driveway, it doesn't look as spacious as it might appear on the plan. Mm-hmm. So you are going to need that space to turn, especially if you have a larger car, into the garage.
Okay. Yeah, and as Mr. Parrott previously pointed out, it's probably tricky too because you have one right-hand drive vehicle and one left-hand drive vehicle, so probably tricky to get that left-hand drive vehicle out the driveway.
Look at exhibit two, for example.
Thank you, Mr. Parrott.
English car in there.
wasn't my catch, it was Mr. Parrott's catch. So, I mean, this is a pretty substantial addition that's being put on to this, and I understand certainly like expanding off on the third floor of the existing structure. That's from within the setbacks, but this additional structure here, I mean, it looks like the main driver for it on the second floor is the master bedroom suite that we got going on here, which is, very impressive. You got, in addition to a good-sized walk-in closet, there's two other storage closets. There's like a seating area, it looks like. I mean, that's a nice-sized bedroom that we have going on here. I guess, what thought, was there any thought given, when these plans are being put together of, at least for that second floor, trying to bring that back in and maybe make it more in line with the 10-foot setback so that the imposing nature on this 5-foot setback is not as much, so that it would only be a one-story setback, similar more to the porch, enclosed in this case, but at least, only one story high, whereas we kind of get this second story and a pretty tall roof. You got a face dormer on there as well. So I'm just looking for thoughts on the how that was put together.
Can I ask Mr. Morrell to approach?
Yeah.
If you could just identify yourself for the record.
I'm Dennis Morrell. I'm the designer on the project. The thought process was obviously making the garage large enough to get the two cars in with the turning radiuses, but then with the space above and what the homeowners wanted to include as part of their the new living space. To make it any smaller would make, it would really shrink those elements down and almost be almost too small, mostly the bedroom space. And that's just how things laid out with, and they were comfortable with that size. And I mean, it could be, I'm sure we could probably shrink some things down a little bit. I think we're over by what, 50, was it 50 square feet? I think it was. Right. So, but that was the thought process. It was trying to make it as comfortable, but not too modest of space.
Yeah, I would agree with that last statement. So, I guess the other question, I always ask it, and you know, you're only asking for 1% relief on building coverage. But at the same point in time, it's 1%. You couldn't like find some 1%. I understand that it sounds like maybe there was some calculation errors or whatnot that came in that maybe drove a little bit of that at the end after the design was put together. But I don't know if there was any thought or an attempt to look at going back and trying to see if you could, you know, make it fully compliant.
Well, we're not going to be able to make it fully compliant with this setback. I mean, we
I understand the setback.
There may be an issue to work with in terms of building coverage. I agree. It's, you know, it's a 24 by 26 garage. It's 26 down here, in part to get storage for things like bikes and strollers and that sort of stuff that you don't really want hanging out outside. And we're removing a porch, so it's not like we can just stow that stuff up on the porch. So that's the reason why. You know, it's possible that modifying that would give us the 0.7 or 0.9 that we need. But overall, you wanted to have a garage deep enough to be something more useful than just a place to put the cars, but a place to put other things. With respect to the master bedroom stuff, I wanted to just draw your attention to the fact that we probably want to, I think we're adding a significant bedroom by putting the master on there, but you know, you don't want to take any space from the existing second floor. You know, the existing second floor is the original house. You want to try to maintain that space and those bedrooms as best you can while putting on this new suite.
Okay, that's all I have for questions, Mr. Hageman.
So just since we're talking about, I know we're basically nitpicking, but being able to basically come within not needing a variance on some of this coverage issues. You mentioned making the garage usable for storage space effectively. Why not narrow the garage and lengthen it so that one side is effectively storage, you still have room for two cars, and you're further away from that lot line. So for example, if I pointed out, it looks like there's several feet in front of the car going towards the lot line. If you tucked that in a bit and then lengthen the garage, you also still have your living space above. It's a bit of a longer room as opposed to a wider room. You have a much better offset from that property line. It's not quite the 10 feet, but it's better than 5. Just throwing out an idea, I wondered if that was considered as opposed to the current setup.
No, there wasn't much consideration to try to, I mean, what took us over the number was accounting for the bulkhead, the AC condensers, and the steps of the two porches. That's kind of where the numbers went higher because of those. If we were to eliminate those, I think we were right about 25%. So that's where the numbers changed.
Okay. But I think the second part of his question was, could you change the shape of the garage and still have the type of things that are wanted in the master bedroom area?
It could probably be reviewed. I'm not saying that it can't be.
Well, I was just curious because it seems like some of the concern is it's no longer just a one-story porch imposing. It's now a two-story imposing a little closer to that lot line, whereas you could remedy some of that issue if you sort of just redesigned or restructured the shape of the garage. Just a thought to throw out.
Yeah.
I do, my understanding based on speaking with Ms. Thomas is that she has spoken with the abutter on that side. She had shared a version of the plans with her that related, I think it's not the set that has the air conditioners on it, but I think she relayed to her an earlier set of the plans so that it was clear what was requested. And I don't believe there's been any negative feedback received from that abutter or any other abutter. I don't know if anyone's here to speak to it tonight, but
we'll find out shortly.
There has been an effort to solicit and include the abutter in that process.
Okay, thank you. Final opportunity for questions, Mr. Parrott.
Just kind of a couple odd questions. Technical illustrations, drawings numbers 1 and 2, both on the general notes referred to the building plan as administered by the town of Northampton, New Hampshire.
Are those, well, they're not completed yet.
Page 3 refers to Portsmouth. But what's the significance of the first two sheets referring to the business, the 2009 IRC building code as administered by the town of Northampton?
That's an error.
Okay, is there any significant difference, do you know? I mean, is there any design features in here that are particular to Northampton and not Portsmouth? I'm just asking you because the building, the inspectors are going to ask you later, so.
Oh, yeah, no, that would be addressed before the plans are actually submitted.
That's just an error in the.
Yes.
That's what I thought, okay, just so we have that on the record. All right, thank you. I'm all set.
Okay, other final questions? All right, thank you very much, we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll open up the public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of this petition? Is there anyone here to wish to speak in opposition? Anyone to speak to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. All right, board, we've had some fair number of questions on this particular application. I'll open up for thoughts from board members.
Well, Dave, I'll just say my thoughts were that, you know, I mean, I think this is a pretty substantial proposal. You know, and what the applicant is looking to do is a pretty significant improvement to the property. But, you know, I don't think the amount of relief that's being requested here is really all that significant. For the amount of work that they're proposing to do, they're really not, I guess, I don't have a huge amount of heartburn with the amount of relief they're requesting.
Okay. Other thoughts?
I would agree with Mr. Mulligan. I think I could support a motion to approve. I mean, the garage is very generously sized, so I do think that the applicant could pretty easily figure out a way to get under that 1%, but I don't have that much. I'm not going to lose much sleep over it. It's an impressive amount of square footage to fit on a small lot. It's a very, when all is said and done, that's a lot of, there's a lot of house there. Mm-hmm. So I do think that the setback is less than it, the setback relief is less than it would be now with the porch, but I do think it will be much more noticeable. But the area that it's situated in and its relationship to the abutter, I think it's a narrow lot neighborhood where, you know, there's a lot of sort of shotgun style lots that are pretty tightly packed in there. And I do think that most of the impact, sort of like the last application, not quite as much as the last application, but most of the impact is really going to be internal to the site, although it is growing. You know, the back of the garage is growing towards the neighborhood.
Okay. Mr. Hagman.
I still have the same concerns and sort of springboarding off of what was being said earlier about the porch. I get that the relief being requested is very modest in the sense that it's improving one of the right yard setback, and the building coverage is only 1% over what is allowed. But the nature of what's being presented before us is it's character-wise very different from what the original violation of the ordinance was. It was a single-story porch, open air. It wasn't an imposing structure, so that is what concerns me. I get that's why I'm torn. It's a modest request, but the nature of the design is a very imposing presence, and I do think that there is room that they could easily get within even needing the building coverage variance, especially since they have such a deep backyard, just by making some minor tweaks to that garage and living space and even pulling it off the lot line a bit to make it less imposing. So that's still a concern of mine.
Okay, thank you. Other thoughts?
Can I just make a comment about the condensers?
Yeah.
Typically, so they weren't included in the original typically they would require, if they're greater than 36 inches and 10 square feet, would require to meet the 10-foot setback. I would just say if you all feel comfortable including them with this, since the setback that they're requesting overall is less than that, I'm just acknowledging that. Otherwise, they would typically be advertised as a separate, treated kind of as an accessory structure. And would be required to meet, have a 10-foot setback for the condensers. They're not part of the structure.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I guess my impression was if we approved the 5 feet, 3 inches,
we're covering
anything that's
within there. Have you acknowledged that includes the condensers?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess I wasn't too concerned about that personally, but. All right, other thoughts? Yeah, I'm torn on this one as well. I do think that the garage is really the driver. It always just irritates me, like, really, you couldn't get that last 1% of coverage. But I understand it's asking for a 1% difference, not that big of a deal. I just do think that this is a pretty substantial addition, as has been talked about. It's going right up against the property line of two pretty significant stories, plus a pretty tall roof going on there. Asking for, as has been pointed out, a good-sized garage and a pretty decently outfitted, master bedroom suite up above there. Could a reasonable house have less? I think so, but is it that imposing? I don't know. I'm kind of torn on, how big of a deal that is. So those are my thoughts. That I would open up for someone who wants to make a motion.
Dave, I'll move to approve as presented and advertised.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, your motion, please.
All right, well, I think there's been some good discussion about this. Again, the applicant's proposing a pretty significant improvement to the property, or series of improvements to the property, but from my position, the amount of relief that's being requested is really fairly minimal. So I'll just go through the criteria. The variance would not be contrary to the public interest, nor would it violate the spirit of the ordinance. Again, the essential characteristics of the neighborhood as a residential neighborhood will not be changed in any way by what's being proposed here. Health, safety, and welfare of the public is really not going to be implicated by either the building coverage increase or the setback relief. Granting the variance results in substantial justice. Here, we have to balance the loss to the applicant against the gain of the public if we were to require strict compliance with the ordinance. This is a lot that you couldn't possibly have strict compliance with. It doesn't have proper frontage.
I'm not sure you opened it up. Public.
I did.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. I apologize. Yeah. I didn't hear it, and neither did they.
Do you want to just try it again, just to make sure? Four against?
I remember opening.
Yeah, I did. Yeah. I did full public commentary. We received just
a fair amount of discussion.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think I was talking about substantial justice, where I think the loss to the applicant outweighs any gain to the public. If we were to require strict compliance with the ordinance, here you have a lot that's already deficient as far as lot area, frontage, and the side yard setback anyway. So I think requiring strict compliance is an unreasonable burden on the applicant. Granting the variance will not diminish values of the surrounding properties. I think to the contrary, this is an applicant that's obviously prepared to sink a huge amount of money into this property, and it's, going to be pretty a substantial, expansive new construction on the property. I think that's only going to increase values of surrounding properties. And finally, literal enforcement of the ordinance, I think, results in an unnecessary hardship. Special conditions of the property are you have a relatively large structure on a relatively narrow lot. I think as the applicant's attorney mentioned, the lot lines aren't at perfect right angles with Wyberd Street, so you've got some, you know, some issues as far as how you get in and out of the garage that's being proposed, and they do need an appropriate turning radius, so they have to account for that. And then, you know, I mean, I get everybody's concern about how you could have designed this differently, but the fact is, at the end of the day, what they've proposed is a very minimal increase in building coverage that would over what's allowed. And the, you know, the setback that they're proposing is actually a slight improvement over what exists. So really, the question comes down to is the fact that it's a setback that's 2.5 stories of encroachment as opposed to one, significant enough that, you know, the hardship criteria is not met, and I just don't, I don't believe it is. I think the where they're proposing to have the encroachment and its relation to the most immediate abutting neighbor, I don't think it's going to have any real significant impact. I mean, I think we say this all the time, that the purpose of setback requirements is to assure that there's, you know, sufficient light, air, access to the properties, et cetera. And, you know, I mean, I think the applicant has been pretty clear about the fact that the existing porch inhibits light, air, and access to the property. And I think that, you know, from the pictures we have, that's true. You know, frankly, if they wanted to keep the porch, I'd probably be okay with that, just because, you know, I think a porch is a nice amenity in a house at this age that, you know, you might want to try and save. But, you know, to their credit, they're removing that to improve the property and stay as close to the building coverage percentage as they can. And, you know, I think it meets all the criteria and it should be approved.
Okay, thank you. Your second, please.
I concur with what Mr. Mulligan just said, and I think the obvious thing is that the most constraining aspect of this whole project is the width of the lot itself. So the house is dated, and in order to bring it up to useful standards by today's view of things, you're going to have to do some substantial construction as has been proposed, but the net amount of relief being requested is pretty modest. So I can support the motion.
Okay, thank you. All right, with that, I'll open up. Any comments on the motion from any board members? All right, with that, we'll move to a vote. The motion is to approve. Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
Mr. Fermella?
Yes.
Mr. Hagman?
No.
And the chair also votes no. You are approved. All right. Next up is case 12-4. Petitioners are Margot L. Thompson for property located at 57 Salter Street. The assessor plan is map 102, lot 32, in the zoning district waterfront business district. The description is to convert an existing accessory structure into a dwelling unit. This requires the following relief: a variance from section 10.440. Use 1.10 to allow a single family dwelling where the use is not allowed in the district. Second, a variance from section 10.311 and section 10.531 to allow a lot area of 11,327 square feet where 20,000 square feet is required, 67 feet of continuous street frontage where 100 feet is required, 4.1 foot front yard where 30 feet is required, and a 0-foot side yard where 30 feet is required, as well as a variance from section 10.321 to allow a non-conforming building or structure to be extended, reconstructed, or enlarged without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance. Who's here to speak on behalf of this petition?
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, I'm Peter Laughlin. I'm here tonight with Margot and Ned Thompson of 57 Salter. Briefly stated, what is being requested tonight is a use similar to, but not exactly the same, as what is now referred to as a garden cottage under the accessory dwelling unit ordinance. The reason it's not exactly a garden cottage is that the planning department has determined that because residential units are not permitted in the waterfront district that garden apartments are, since they're only permitted on single-family lots in the residential districts, this can't be considered to be submitted under a garden apartment, garden cottage request. Plus, there's a few feet difference in size as to what is required. Because the lot does not meet the lot area and frontage requirements, and because the structure housing the dwelling unit does not meet the setback requirements, variance relief is required. And because it lies in the waterfront district, where dwelling units are not specifically permitted, a use variance is required. The Thompsons purchased this property in 1990, and when it was purchased, there were two lots at the end of Salter Street, and there was a home on each of those lots. And I suspect, unlike 90% of the applications that come before you, the petitioners did not come in and ask to add more units or somehow subdivide the lot. They asked to combine the two lots before the Board of Adjustment and to combine the two buildings. So they went from two lots and two buildings to single-family homes to one lot with one single-family home. And tonight we're seeking the ability to convert a workshop or office that was updated in 1990 with all utilities. And tonight we're asking essentially to be able to put a kitchen in that unit, which would make it a dwelling unit. There's already plumbing in it. Although the Thompson's lot is at 10,000 plus square feet, is larger than almost all of the surrounding lots, because it does not meet the area and frontage requirements in the waterfront business district, relief from those requirements is being requested. And even though the Thompson's lot is the fifth largest of the 32 lots in the area that's bounded by Massey Street on the west, the Sagamore Creek tidal channel on the north, and the Little Harbor or Piscataqua River to the south and east. There are 32 lots there, none of them meet the 20,000 square foot requirement, and none of the 18 lots in the waterfront business district meet the minimum requirements for the waterfront business district. And because the workshop is located in the front yard next to the street at the edge of the dock on the east property line, which was likely put there for the convenience of boat building or other marine or marine railway or other historic uses, relief from the front and side setbacks is needed for the proposed dormer and for the overhangs. The proposed 219 square foot overhangs over the two exterior doors, and they're also relocating the stairs from the front to the side, making them actually more conforming. And of course, the dormer is an expansion of a non-conforming use and requires relief. And I've outlined in my letter why we feel we meet all five conditions for the grant of a variance. I'll be happy to go through those, but I think that in this case, I think they're pretty self-explanatory. In terms of the use variance that we need, of the 32 lots in this neighborhood, I believe that there are two that are used for, and that includes zoned for residential and waterfront. I believe there are two that are actually used for waterfront business, and those are the Saunders Lobster Company. And fortuitously for the Saunders, for that business and for the neighborhood, that particular property has access by two streets. So trucks can go in one street and go out the other, and there's a rather large area for maneuvering at the Saunders property. The rest, other than those two lots out of 32, as far as I know, every other single lot is used exclusively for residential purposes. You've seen in my letter the list of permitted uses in the waterfront business district, and it's, unusual list. I mean, it's fairly, some ways it's fairly expansive, but if you look at those, I don't think there's a single one that would really work in most of the waterfront business district, and certainly not on this particular property. And I guess as an example of why waterfront business district doesn't work, and I reference this in my letter, and there's a case in 1974, 1975 involving the prior owner of this property, Roger Gagnon. And Mr. Gagnon was making lobster traps on his property, which seems like a marine use. He was also fiberglassing boats. And the testimony in that, what happened is that there were concerns from the neighbors. The fiberglass covered the smells and fumes, covered the entire neighborhood. The noise from the ripping the wood for lobster traps was very loud, annoying, burdensome. And the heavy trucks that brought the lumber and whatever to drive down Salter Street and very often back all the way back out, and then the pickup trucks of the lobstermen had to drive down and pick up the lobster traps. So it was a terrible burden on the neighbors. And the city issued a cease and desist order, and the Mr. Gagnon applied for a variance to this board, a prior board, and but his lawyers advised him to withdraw that application and claim that he had a non-conforming use. And that led to the litigation. And and at the end of the day, the legal issue was fairly narrow, but the testimony and information that came out at trial just, I think, reinforced why nothing in that neighborhood really, other than maybe the Saunders property, makes sense for a waterfront business district. And in some ways, it was a classic example, in my opinion, of a small town practice. The mayor's mother-in-law, Bruce Graves was the mayor's mother-in-law, lived diagonally across the street. And so they alleged in their petition that the only reason the city was bringing this was because of the mayor's mother lived across the street. Well, the mayor's mother, like my mother, and I suspect the mothers of most of you, the last thing she would do would be get involved. The reason that nothing happened was nobody, she never would complain. She didn't want to involve her son-in-law. And but that was alleged. It was also alleged that, well, this was a non-conforming use because Mr. Gagnon had made a substantial part of his income from manufacturing boats and lobster traps. And I'm sure that, I shouldn't say I'm sure, that probably was influenced by his creativity of his lawyers. And city filed I felt a little guilty about it, but filed a motion to have him produce his tax records. Since he was producing his income from that business and it was a non-conforming use, he might have mentioned that on his tax records, but for some reason there was no indication of any income from the 3 or 4 years he'd been doing this. So the city ended up with a reasonable decision, and but the part I thought was neat was that Roger Gagnon was a welder, a very skillful welder. My dad was a welder. I kind of liked the guy, even though he was raising havoc in the neighborhood. And so when it became clear that we were going to shut him down and close down his livelihood, I called the economic development director at the time and said, have you got any places in Portsmouth where you could get some cheap space where somebody could build boats, which he wanted to do, and do lobster traps? And they found a place down at the railroad yard, and he went on to build a couple of very large boats and was rather successful down there. And every time that, and I couldn't call him directly, but the development director did, And every time Roger Gagnon went by, when I was running, he would never fail to wave. And Marsha Carlton, who was here in court, was critical in the successful prosecution of the case. She was right next door and suffered probably more than anybody else from the noise and trucks and everything else. And it was back when you used to have two-day trials rather than 15-minute trials like we have now. And the court, it was pretty bitterly contested. And but another part of the kind of neat part about local practice is that one of the lawyers on the other side, I saw at the Edgewood Center on Sunday, and told him about, I was planning to talk about his case on Tuesday night, and not in support of his side. But I think that hopefully proves that it's not, waterfront business district use doesn't apply, work here, and the use that's proposed, a residential use, having a 696 square foot existing structure used for a dwelling unit, the ability to use it as a dwelling unit, does make sense. It's not going to diminish various surrounding properties. It's, in fact, if anything, what would diminish the value of surrounding properties is any use permitted in the commercial, in the waterfront business district. It's going to be in keeping with the spirit and intent of the ordinance. Substantial justice will be done. It is unique. This property is unique. It's got water on two sides. There's only one other lot of those 32 that actually has water on two sides. And in fact, this little workshop place has water. The lot has water on two sides, and this essentially has water on two sides because the if you look at the way the tide comes in, it comes up almost around this on one side, plus and back. So it's the size of the lot, its location. All suggest that there is something unique and it causes an unnecessary hardship. And I cited one case, and that's Belanger versus the City of Nashua, a 1981 case, which I had forgotten, was actually argued in the Supreme Court by our Robert P. Sullivan when he was Assistant Corporation Counsel in Nashua. And in that case, the court said, that your zoning has to reflect existing conditions. Nashua, the property was zoned single-family residence or residential. It had become commercial over the years. The court said it doesn't represent commercial use any longer. It should be that it was improper for the Board of Adjustment to deny a commercial use. Here it's application of the law, and that this property really shouldn't be zoned waterfront business district any longer, but there's probably no constituency to come in and argue against about changing the zoning. I know it happens, it's been happening one lot by one at a time, but it just doesn't really work. To have this, and as a result, I think it's appropriate that variance relief be granted. So I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you. Questions for the applicant, Mr. Hageman.
Just one. I understand they want to make this a dwelling unit, but can you give a little description as to what kind of dwelling unit, a rental, a family space for extra summer stays? What's the intended use?
Ned probably can best answer that. It won't be big family space.
I have a brother who has leukemia, and I have an 82-year-old mother-in-law, and we're not getting any younger. The idea is that we'd like to age in place, and so we're planning ahead.
Okay. Thank you. All right, other questions? Mr. Parrott.
In view of the fact that this use isn't allowed in the district, what in your judgment would be the applicable parking requirements? There's not much space there when you go and look at that.
I would say I think it's at 1.3 spaces per dwelling unit, but I think that there are, at least when I went down, it appeared to me that you could have four parking spaces could fit in the on the either the pavers or the pavement at that location.
Yeah, but the use isn't allowed. So how can you come to the conclusion there is any requirement?
Well, I'm just saying that I had assumed that a reasonable number of parking spaces, a requirement would be four, and there is room for four parking spaces on the property. Maybe I'm not understanding the question.
You're making an assumption, if this were zone residential, that a four parking space requirement would make sense.
Yes.
Yeah, but it's not.
It's not.
You're making, I'm forcing you to do it, but you're making something up that isn't in the an ordinance that we have to go by, is my point.
Right. Also true.
I'm not sure I'm understanding, because so there's room on the site for four parking spaces.
Now, that's not my question.
Well, I'm not sure I'm understanding.
My question is, we go by the ordinance in here, which says for X, Y, and Z use, you have associated numbers of parking spaces, and then we have dimensional requirements for parking spaces. But this is a non-allowed use. So how can you say it has any use, any requirements or no requirements?
Well, I suppose it'd be
trying to figure out how am I to vote to approve something when it obviously parking is already required.
But if we're in the twilight zone so much.
I'm trying to make.
We would need to go and try and imagine, does this make sense? Now, I know in your staff report, you indicated a requirement of three parking spaces. Where did you come up with that?
Well, the existing house, which was approved in 1990 with variances,
yeah,
require two, and then the additional, if this dwelling unit is approved, for a dwelling unit, it would require one space.
Okay. But based on what?
Well, if we were to allow a variance, we would be calling it a residential use. Therefore, it would have to meet residential parking requirements. Isn't that basically?
Yeah.
We're sort of tagging it as we're saying, okay, this is not waterfront business anymore. It's a residential use, and we have a blanket policy we have an equation for residential parking.
Right. In essence, but we are rezoning it in a certain sense.
I know I'm trying to beat this, but I've been thinking about this a lot. But other things tag along. For example, the requirements about being able to back out on the street or not back out on the street.
Right.
So there's associated requirements that come with a particular use, and this use is not allowed.
Right, and those are the things we need to take a look at as we move forward with this property, and backing out onto the street, those kinds of considerations. I mean, I think that's...
But those don't apply to single and two-family homes.
Right.
They only apply to multi-use, yeah. To multi-family.
Perhaps, I know, at your last meeting, you approved an attached accessory dwelling unit on a 7,500-square-foot lot. And so that second dwelling unit wasn't a permitted use on there because the lot was too small, and it didn't meet the requirements for an accessory dwelling unit under the zoning ordinance, so they needed variance relief. So you had to assume, I guess, at that point, well, in fact, I think there was discussion about creating additional parking spaces. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, I think you just have to, in that case, and in this case, you applied, okay, when we get done with this, we've got two dwelling units, and the parking requirement for two dwelling units is three. I was going to say four, but when I went down and pulled into the lot, I didn't have to back out into the street, and there was ample room to maneuver on property. I thought even for four parking spaces.
Yeah. In fact, my final comment is that very case you cite is one of the things that's brought this to my mind, because in the case of where we approve a non-approved use for a location, a specific location, what ancillary other requirements does that then apply? The ones with the new use or the ones that apply to the rest of the district? I'm not asking that question. I'm just making that rhetorical point that I've been thinking about this and I can't come up with a logical answer, and it certainly is not answered in the ordinance.
Well, since it was a rhetorical question, then I won't try to answer.
Well, I'm not trying to force an answer.
So from the planning staff standpoint, I mean, you're looking at it as if it would be essentially turned into residential, like some of the other requirements and whatnot that are applicable. Is that what you're also looking at this?
Right, the backing out is allowed since it's right. One or two family.
Mr. Chairman,
I mean, I would think that we would, most of those requirements don't come with what zone a building is in. It's what the building is being used for. You know what I mean?
Right. Mm-hmm. I since we're sort of airing all this now with while making you also stand here, one question I had was, are we sidestepping any kind of ADU process that would otherwise be undertaken in a different district by virtually just rubber stamping saying, okay, this ADU is allowed?
Mm-hmm.
That would be my concern, is that it's right. A non-approved use, and we have this whole new view on ADUs, and this looks like this fits that bill, and is there a process that normally would be undertaken to
mm-hmm.
go through the planning for that? Yeah.
I would just say, I, my opinion on that would be, since it's not a residential zone, there is really is no ADU application, but I mean, it's a really good point.
Yeah, and we can talk more about that when we get into the discussion. I would like to let Attorney Lachlan sit down if we, what other questions do we have for all right, I do have a couple.
Just one, we had assumed we were applying for an AD, I had assumed we were applying for an ADU, and the planning staff said, no, it's not, you've got to apply for variance relief that, because it's not residential, you don't qualify for it.
Understand. I do have a couple questions. Sorry, I wasn't going to let you get off that easily. So I'm a little confused. In the 1980 property, it's really like a tax map that you have here. It's your exhibit number 6. It shows the frontage on Salter Street is 96 feet, yet your current plans and your application here indicate that the frontage on Salter Street is only 67 feet. Where did the almost 30 feet go?
I think that's climate change. It's water level has increased that much.
Well, that's what I was thinking.
Actually,
I actually wrote that in my notes on my.
The
is it climate change.
It's I used and I think I put a footnote explaining that I used the dimensions when I was comparing it to other lots, and in the application I used the dimensions on the present tax map. But the when it was actually surveyed, there was less frontage, and the lot size was like 1,000 feet more than what the tax map showed.
Okay. Yeah, it just seems like an awfully big difference. I mean, I agree tax maps aren't terribly accurate, but that's even bad for a tax map. So just understanding the 0-foot setback that you're requesting, and I'm presuming that's because essentially this structure goes over the water line, and which is in essence the edge of the property line, and that's what's driving this concept of 0-foot setback. It's actually almost like a negative setback, right?
I don't know if it's over the property line or not. It's right on the dock.
Salter Street.
I think it's a side yard.
The side yard.
The front yard at 0, and the side yard may be 0 also on the right side.
I guess it depends on how you view side.
Street side is 0, I believe.
Salter Street is the front.
Salter Street is the front.
4 feet.
Right.
The right side facing the dock is the 0 feet where 30 feet is required.
Right. So it's considered 0 feet because it's going over the mean water line.
Yes.
Okay. All right. And then there were no floor plans provided for this structure. So it's 2 stories, correct? And you got the exterior stairwell going up to the, or set of stairs going up to the second floor. I guess I'm trying to understand what's on the first floor and what's on the second floor. Is it really truly just one dwelling unit that you basically have to go outside to go between your two floors?
I believe so. Ned can speak.
We're working with the building department
to come up with what type of stairs we can put inside the space.
Okay.
And those stairs go up the outside. They exist as they sit now. Mm-hmm. They'd just be moved to the side. And that would be a second egress out of the second floor.
Okay.
It is solely a one unit. The top floor is a bedroom and a bathroom. The second floor is a kitchen and a place for two chairs.
Okay. So within this very tiny footprint, you will find some way of putting an internal set of stairs.
Yes, sir.
Somehow. Okay. And it's the total square footage on, between the two floors, is that 690 or is it something greater than that? Or?
Well, no. Excuse me. No, I think it's less than that. But
okay,
If you measure the exterior perimeter of the building
yeah.
versus the interior walls, I don't know. Comes out significantly less than 600 interior space. But the outside walls are, in some cases, almost a foot thick.
Okay, so we're talking tiny home living here.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right.
Could I add something, or is this sure. the inappropriate moment?
Nope.
Almost all the cars on the street back out onto the road or back into the driveways.
Yeah.
Okay, just as if you go up and down the street, you'll see most people have to back in and out. And there's, we have space, I don't know if it was Peter or Vincent Hayes that actually, or no, it was Nick Cracknell who drew the cars just to see how many cars we could get in there according if it was zoned residential. And he came up, there were four spots for cars. That was his comment. If it is zoned residential, no, this is not.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, and I would think this one additional structure, I mean, if you actually had two cars, I think I'd spend more time out in my cars than I would inside the structure. It's probably like more room. So, I mean, I don't anticipate like a lot of parking needs for a small structure like this, would be my guess. Just a thought. Okay. That is all I have for questions. Thank you. All right, just to make sure I don't forget it, we will open up the public hearing. Is there anyone here who wishes to speak in favor of the petition? Is there anyone here who wishes to speak in opposition? Anyone who wishes to speak to, for, or against, please rise.
Marsha McCormick, 53 Salter Street. And first of all, Peter, thanks for taking us down memory lane. It's Waterfront business is a bizarre, completely inappropriate zone for that area. My only concern would be just shifting, another residence. I mean, even though it's just a cottage, it's still, that's a big house. Then we have this other place to live. I'm thinking in terms of the whole street because there's a big, huge house on the corner and this house. And even though it's the intention is to age in place, after a while you're done aging and you've got pretty big, very big houses. If it's still waterfront business, then what have we got? I mean, what would be permissible? Then would it be, could you have like a restaurant? Could you have, I don't even know what the
criteria
is.
Talk to the board.
What?
I just need to have you talking to the board. So.
Oh, okay, sorry. So I don't know. I'm just thinking out loud about what the potential is when we do something like this. I'm not against it. I'm not really for it. I'm just talking.
Okay.
All right?
Thank you.
That's it.
We
thanks.
Appreciate it. Thank you. All right, anyone else to speak to, for, or against?
To talk to Marsha's point, which is well made, our property was divided. There were two dwelling units there. We combined them, as Peter said. Zach and Nicole at the top of the street, I don't know how many units were in there at one time, that the Zach and Nicole Gregg's house, but I think there were like two or three units in there. So. The street has become, the usage has become less intense over the years. And so we would be increasing it by probably one or two people because the space won't hold more than that, so.
Okay, great, thank you.
Yes, the one use that is permitted, which I think is pretty incredible, is the, you can have a fish market.
anywhere in the waterfront business district. And one other thing about the small town practice, I met Marcia Carlton through this case, and she's been a friend for the last 35 years as a result. So it's kind of been a neat experience, the whole thing.
Okay, thank you. All right, final opportunity. Anyone to speak to, for, or against? All right, seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. All right, board, this is a unique one. What are our thoughts?
I had a question about the zero foot offset in the right yard. Is that just referring to the main structure on the property, not even this smaller cottage?
No, it's referring to the cottage. So if you're on Salter Street and as you face it, the cottage is to the right-hand side of the property.
Yeah.
It is shoved all the way over to the property line because it's up against the mean water line. In fact, I think it's a little over the mean water line, right?
Yep. And am I right in thinking, Attorney Loughlin?
Loughlin.
To the point of he came to the planning staff and then assumed it was an ADU process, and they said no because it's not a residential district. Would we in essence be granting a variance that allows a residential unit, and then they would have to go through the ADU process after that, or this is just a flat?
This is just asking for a single family dwelling.
Okay.
Not an ADU, just a dwelling unit.
Right. So we would, right, we would be granting what in essence is like an ADU, but we would be not going through the, it will not have to go back through a planning board for a conditional use permit.
Right.
Still has to go through the Historic District Commission
and
the Conservation Commission because of the fact that it's on the water.
Yes.
All right, thoughts?
So all the dimensional relief that's requested here is basically based on the existing conditions.
Correct.
So really this boils down to a use variance for, you know, a second residential dwelling,
right,
in what is, you know, evolved into a primarily residential area.
Right. That and the location of this other dwelling unit, is it because of the setbacks in a bad location or not, I guess.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, in terms of its location, I mean, it's on the, I mean, yeah, you have a 0 foot setback, but it's not like there's going to be light and air issues. It's up against the river. It's pretty modest structure overall.
Does it have to go through any structural inspections before it's granted living space? Like,
I'm sure the building inspector, because it's converting it from accessory to residential use, so I'm sure that will happen.
Well, I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay.
Unless somebody else wants to stop me.
I'm ready to listen to a motion.
All right. I move to approve as presented and advertised.
Okay. Second. Is there a second? I'm sorry.
Second.
All right. Go ahead.
Okay. Motion, well, so as I just stated, the dimensional relief, I think, is pretty self-explanatory because it's just based on the existing conditions. There's really no physical change to the property being proposed that is driving any of that relief, so we would just be approving what's already existing on the ground. So this to me just comes down to a use variance and whether or not it's appropriate to have a second residential dwelling on this property, and I think it is. I think as the applicant and others have pointed out, other permitted uses would probably be even worse for the neighborhood than a very, very modest residential dwelling. It has been alluded to here that there's been a movement towards promoting accessory dwellings in residential, formal residential neighborhoods. And since this isn't one of those, that doesn't apply here. But I think the same, the same policy arguments in favor of those would apply just about anywhere that is primarily residential, which this neighborhood has evolved into. So just to hit the criteria, granting the variances would not be contrary to the public interest, nor would they be contrary to the spirit of the ordinance. The essential character of the neighborhood is not going to be altered irrevocably by what's being proposed here, nor is the health, safety, and welfare of the public going to be affected at all. Granting the variance results in substantial justice. Here we have to weigh the loss to the applicant if we were to deny this variance against the gain to the public. I can't see any gain to the public. This is an extremely modest amount of living space that's going to be added to a very large property. Granted, the variance will not diminish values of the surrounding properties. I don't think surrounding properties are going to be affected at all by this. The physical layout of the property isn't changing at all. Finally, literal enforcement of the ordinance results in an unnecessary hardship. This is a fairly unique lot. It's surrounded by water on at least two sides. It's at the dead end of Salter Street. It's certainly unique compared to the other properties in the neighborhood. It's a fairly large property, and it's a property that doesn't lend itself to any of the existing permitted uses anywhere in this particular zone. So I don't think there's any fair and substantial relationship between the purpose of the uses that are permitted in this waterfront business zone and their application of this property. So I think the use that's being proposed here is a reasonable one. And it meets all the criteria and should be granted.
Okay, thank you. Your second, please.
I concur with Mr. Mulligan and have nothing new to add.
Okay. Comments on the motion from any board members? I say I will support the motion just to sort of talk about the Waterfront Business District. We've had a couple other applications in front of the board over the past few years that involve this district. It is kind of an odd one in that it represents a lot of desire, I think, on the part of the city to try and preserve something unique and special about these neighborhoods and their long time history and link to the sea. But at the same point in time, realistically, as the applicants pointed out, many of the properties really don't fit the idea, the idealized waterfront business concept is just not, and when the constraints of these properties, such as access down very, very narrow streets, the nature of the properties themselves, just the fact that they're abutting very residential areas that have, once upon a time were relatively inexpensive homes, now are something very different. That quaint vision of the waterfront business district is just not reality in many, many locations, including, I think, as the applicant has made a pretty strong argument in this particular case. If this was a case of something that currently had a waterfront business use and their proposal was to eliminate that in favor of residential, I think I would be much more defensive of it. But I think it's proven that this really, even the last attempt at using it for some type of business purpose didn't fare very well. It has a fairly substantial history at this point now, going on a few decades of being successfully used as a residential property. It just doesn't make sense to somehow now try and constrict its further use as a residential property just to sort of, further this idealized concept of the waterfront business district. So with that, I'm ready to go to a vote. The motion is to approve. Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
Mr. Formella?
Yes.
Mr. Hageman?
Yes.
And the chair also votes yes, you are approved.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, it's a little past 9 o'clock. We have one case left. Just looking for a sense from the board. Do you guys need a 5-minute break or do you want to press on? Let's get through that last case.
Press on.
All right, I see no urgent need for a break, so we'll press on through and skip our normal 9 o'clock break. We will, for our next case 12-5, we will be having Mr. Mulligan will be recusing. There'll be 6 board members, voting members for this application. Case 12-5, petitioners are 56 Middle Street LLC for property conveniently located at 56 Middle Street. The assessor plan is map 126, lot 19, in the zoning district, character district 4L1. The description is a garage addition and residential use on the ground floor. This requires a variance from section 10.642 and 10.5A32 to allow residential principal use on the ground floor of a building, and a variance from section 10.5A41.10A to allow a 1.7-foot rear yard setback where 5 feet is required. And notably, some of those requirements, variance is also part of the fact that this property is located in the downtown overlay district. Who is here to speak on behalf of this petition?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Tom Watson. I'm an attorney with the firm of Drummond Woodson in Portsmouth, and I'm here on behalf of the applicant, 56 Middle Street, LLC. The principals of 56 Middle Street LLC are Jason and Barbara Theodore. Unfortunately, they could not join us tonight because they had longstanding plans to be in New Mexico, which is where they are, and they probably can't watch us on local television either. So I'm appearing on their behalf, and hopefully I'll be able to answer all your questions concerning the project. So this is a very interesting property. I'm sure everyone is familiar with it, having driven by it how many times a day for however long you've lived in this town. This property has had a residential life, so to speak, throughout most of its existence until somewhere in the mid-1960s. So the oldest part of it, and I'm not even quite sure how far it goes back as a residence, but I can say that it at least goes back as far as 1845. Research at the Athenaeum shows that it was a Gothic Revival home was constructed on the property as a residence. It became known as the Glen Cottage. It was constructed for an individual who owned a soap factory here in town. And it remained that way throughout the rest of the 19th century. In the early part of the 20th century, it 1910, it appears, a significant addition was added to it. The tax assessor's cards would suggest that the house was constructed in 1910, but only a portion of the house was constructed in 1910. The front half of the house, which is the Tudor Revival style, was constructed during that period of time. As you look at the plans that are shown on the screen, the sort of little more squarish with the rounded bump out on it that is closest to Middle Street, that's the Tudor Revival. That long rectangular piece that runs to near the back property line, that actually still is the remains of the Gothic Revival. One of the interesting tidbits that came up in the research about this property is that when the Portsmouth Advocates did their research on the house in the 1980s, it was described as being one of the most unique properties in Portsmouth for blending two complementary styles that weren't colonial and federal. So it actually is a pretty unique property in the city. And again, throughout most of its existence, it was served as a single-family residence. At some point, it looks like before 1948, because one of the exhibits you'll see is a 1948 plan, a small addition was placed on the back of the property. That's the one that you'll see is designated to become a two-story garage and with a bedroom suite above it. It appears that at some point, after that was constructed, probably in the 1950s, a dentist used the property as his single family residence and had, I guess for lack of a better term, a home office or an accessory use of that L out back as his personal dental office. And then in the 1960s, the Griffin Law Firm acquired the property and converted it to law offices. Ironically, again, it was residential at the time. Ironically, they had to get a variance from this board in order to use it as professional offices instead of a single family residence. It shows you how we've come full circle. The Griffin firm continued to use the property as a law firm until about 2012. And then somewhere in the late 80s, it began to sublease portions of the property for other general commercial office use, and that continues until this day. In August, my clients purchased the property, and their proposal is to restore the house as a single-family residence. As the plans and the renderings that were submitted as part of the package indicates, in addition to changing the use of the first floor of the property, and I should say the upper floors today continue to be are used as offices as well, so they would convert the entire first floor and upper floors to single-family residential use, And then what they hope to do or propose to do is to take what is now a one-story sort of office type of space that's in that addition in the very rear of the property and convert that to a two-stall garage on the first floor, bedroom suite on the second floor. The property lies in a character four district, and as it turns out, a single-family dwelling is a permitted use in the character district, and we wouldn't be here today seeking a variance but for the fact that this property also happens to lie on the very edge of the downtown overlay district. And as I'm sure you're aware, the downtown overlay district does not permit residential use on the first floor. It allows it on the upper floors of the structure, but not on the first floor. So one of the things we're seeking today is a use variance to allow that first floor of that building to be converted and used for residential purposes. The second one, second variance is a dimensional variance, and that relates to the fact that as the property sits, that addition on the very back is 1.7 feet from the rear property line, but not the entire stretch of that property, but just about 4 feet of that back wall. And that is because if you look at the plan, this is a very unusual lot. It's not a four-sided lot or a five-sided lot or a six-sided lot. It's a 12-sided lot. This is a zigzag puzzle piece, in fact. In fact, the back side, the back lot line, has five runs in it, lot line runs. So it's a very unusual piece, and the result was that, again, sometime more than 70 years ago and prior to 1948, when that addition was put on the back end, presumably because in order to have it connect to the existing house, you had to have some of it near that property line, about 4 feet corner of that property sits only 1.7 feet where the existing ordinance now requires a 5-foot distance between the structure and the rear property line. So we're seeking a dimensional variance for that limited expansion. Again, the building's been there long before this particular zoning requirement existed, so it's a non-conforming, so-called grandfathered use. But the fact that we're now going to have a second floor on the structure means that it's interpreted as being an expansion, and that's why we're asking for that variance. So as the board is well aware, there are five criteria that the applicant has to meet in order to obtain a variance. The first two are oftentimes treated the same because they are very similar. In fact, those two being granting the variance will not be contrary to the public interest, and the spirit and intent of the ordinance will be observed. In fact, the courts have generally said that, you know, one is substantially related to the other, and if one fails, the other fails, and if one meets the criteria, generally it meets the second criteria as well. So the test in this area is whether the variance will unduly conflict with the basic zoning objectives of the ordinance. So when we look at that, it has to be more than simply it conflicts with the ordinance. It has to be something that alters the essential character of the neighborhood or adversely affects the health, safety, and welfare of the public. In this case, we know that the purposes of the Portsmouth Zoning Ordinance are the promotion of health, safety, and welfare, and that's done through implementing the goals of the master plan. And we know that the master plan calls for land use regulation to promote vibrancy, authenticity, diversity, resiliency, and connectedness. I suggest that restoring a structure that was originally designed and used as a single-family residence back to its original use will neither violate the health, safety, and welfare of the public. I can't see how that could possibly adversely affect the health, safety, and welfare. And I also I can't see how it would adversely affect the objectives of the master plan. It certainly isn't going to impact vibrancy. It's not going to impact connectedness or anything of that nature. So In fact, I would suggest that if one of the criteria of the master plan is authenticity, that restoring this building to its original use will in fact promote the authenticity of a structure in the city of Portsmouth. It also, as you know, one of the basic objectives of the downtown overlay district, the one that results in the restriction on first floor uses as residences, is to promote economic vitality in the downtown area. And again, I think it's important to understand that what this request doesn't do. So this request doesn't ask that a commercially designed building somewhere in the downtown area be converted to residential. This isn't like some of the ones that we saw years ago on Lower State Street that were storefronts that ended up being bricked up and becoming residential. So it's not that type of thing. And it's also not asking, this is a structure that's on the very, very literally the very edge of the downtown overlay district. This isn't a structure that's on, you know, Market Street or Bow Street or Congress Street, which is, you know, purely commercial in nature. We're not looking to sort of shut down a commercial structure that would in fact impact the those districts. This is one that, you know, in fact it looks like a residence. You know, if it quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. And in this case, this building looks like a residence. It's not going to impact the level of traffic or the appearance within that neighborhood. Because it sits on the edge of the downtown overlay district, it also happens to sit in a transition area. So this isn't again Congress Street or Market Street or Bow Street or one of those areas. This is, in many ways, this intersection is the gateway from that sort of urban residential neighborhood that sits between Middle Street and Islington Street, of which, in my opinion, State Street is the spine. State Street is sort of the, if anybody was to sit on that corner for a couple hours on a Saturday, you'd see more residential pedestrians coming into downtown through this intersection. And I would submit to the board that the particular use of this building is not going to impact that. Also, because of the peculiar way by which the boundaries of the downtown overlay district were set out, if you note from Exhibit 2, this property is almost totally unique at its location. The downtown overlay district sort of comes in, turns just to catch this corner, and then heads down Middle Street toward municipal uses, museum uses, and other types of uses. So it's in a mixed use area. Mixed use not only because it involves, you know, residential as well as retail, commercial, museum, that type of thing, but also because the first floor in this area has both residential and commercial. It just so happens that boundary line is what separates our structure from the ones immediately next to it that are similar. Any one of those structures could be converted to a single family residence tomorrow. This one cannot, simply because it happens to be on that very edge of the overlay district. So in my opinion, this really is consistent with the purposes and intent of the ordinance, and it certainly doesn't create any adverse impact on any of those purposes. Similarly, the dimensional requirement, primary purpose for the character district is to encourage development that is compatible with existing characters of the neighborhood. Now, if you take a look at the exhibit number one, which is the tax map, you'll see something very interesting about this neighborhood, and that is that we all know that this neighborhood is a very old neighborhood. It has very small lots, by and large, and it also has a lot of lots where the buildings are literally right on the property line. They are the property line. If you look at that plan, that tax map, you'll see that the property immediately to the north of 56 Middle Street, the three or four or five properties to the west, the property that is south of that, directly across from State Street, every single one of those properties sits right on their boundary lines. And in fact, you know, if you look at the ones to the east and southeast, while they don't run along the property line, parts of them come right up to the property line. So the nature and the character of this neighborhood is a neighborhood of small lots where by and large, because of the traditional development, people have tried to make the most use of those lots by building right up to the property edges. And that, and, you know, I would suggest that this particular lot has helped define what the character of this neighborhood is, and therefore allowing for a minor further deviation by allowing for a second story is not going to change that character at all. It's going to continue to maintain the character that's been there for probably 150 years.
So we've had your 15 minutes, if you can just, you know, try and
okay, I apologize. All right, so the third one is obviously granting a variance will do substantial justice. The courts have said that the guiding factor here, of course, is that any loss to the owner that's not outweighed by a gain to the public is an injustice. And the real question, again, is the proposed use or proposed development consistent with the area's present use? I won't repeat what I just said, but the analysis I used about the nature of the neighborhood is the same use that we're continuing to propose here, including the use as a single-family residence. The next question is whether it will result in any diminution in the value of surrounding properties. This property looks like a single-family residence. It will continue, if it's used as a single-family residence, to look like that. There's nothing that's going to overdevelop or create any adverse effects that would impact its value or anybody's value next to it. In fact, if the conventional wisdom is that residential properties are going up in value quicker than commercial ones, then I would suggest that this would only favorably impact the value of surrounding properties. Certainly, as a residential use, there'll be less traffic, there'll be less noise, less glare, any of those factors that traditionally emanate from commercial properties will not apply here. So the last issue, the one it always draws the most attention, is whether we can say that a literal enforcement of the ordinance will result in an unnecessary hardship. I would suggest that this property has special conditions that make it unique, and they result from the fact that unlike most of the structures in the downtown overlay district, this property was constructed as a single family home. Most of its existence was a single family home. It continues to have the same design as a single family home, and it isn't something where at some point in time it was converted to a commercial design structure that would have storefronts or anything of that nature. So this property is not contributing to that vibrancy on the street that I think the downtown overlay district is trying to promote. This property is really sort of neutral in that regard. It's also unique because it's there are several buildings similar to this where there are residential uses on the first floor, but it's just that the boundary line between the overlay district and the regular characteristics is right on our property line. That's what makes this one unique. So final comment is whether this is a reasonable use, and I would suggest that residential is probably the most reasonable use of this property that you could have without tearing it down and allowing the property to remain undeveloped. It's minimal traffic, minimal noise. It blends in beautifully in that transition area, that sort of gateway from the urban residential area to the downtown area. I would suggest to the board that there's really it would be hard pressed to suggest that using this first floor as residential is an unreasonable use of the property in any way.
Okay.
Happy to answer your questions.
Great, thank you. Questions for the applicant's representative? Yes, Mr. Hagman.
I have three questions.
Wow, okay.
pretty basic questions. is any aspect of the building being used by a commercial business at the moment?
Office space. It's being used as office space.
It's occupied right now?
Yep.
You mentioned restoring the use back to residential. Do the owners of the property intend to try and keep the outside similar to what it is now in terms of the Gothic and Tudor revival and how it resembles?
No, exactly. In fact, you'll see from the renderings that the addition on the back, instead of being sort of a flat one-story thing, will take up the same Tudor revival style architecture. That rendering isn't necessarily the final one that will be submitted to the HDC, but that's the intent, is to, you know, create a unifying theme in the whole structure.
Right, and this is within the historic district, yeah. So the HDC will also get an opportunity to wait.
Too, just to not here, but of Peter. Last question on State Street. I know that there are other commercial uses, sort of catty corner and adjacent, and then there's the Keefe apartments on the other side, but those houses along State Street next to it, are those residential or also commercial?
Where on State Street?
Next to the property. So if you went further down State Street, I believe there's like three buildings that appear to be homes moving away from Middle Street down State Street.
Okay. So the answer is, I believe that they're mixed use. But I know there's an appraisal office in there. There's a law firm in one of them. Mm-hmm. I think most of those have commercial use.
Okay.
They're free to have whichever use they want.
Because, yeah. Yep. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, other questions? All right, I do have just one, and I actually that is C1. Is that C1 that's up on the screen here? I'm just trying to understand. Note 10 of C1 talks about the easement rights to allow access to your back garage, and it says it goes over properties 17 and 16, which actually I don't even see 16 on this particular illustration. But just could you explain like how cars are going to get back to your garage that's being built back there?
Sure. May I approach the plan?
Yeah, if you speak, I just have to have you bring that. We'd still have like two people watching at home, so.
So as this plan indicates, to the rear of, this is 56 Middle, yep. To the rear is the property owned by Ed Mallon. And then there is behind that a passageway that I believe is a public right-of-way.
Okay.
In fact, on early plans, you'll see that noted as an extension of Porter Street.
Right, it's a street, yeah.
It runs in just to the edge of his back lot. And then this area behind his property and what will become the garage, all the way over to this area, is also part of our lot. And then there are three lots in this direction. So this is a public thing of which my client's property has rights to use. Mm-hmm. And years ago when attorneys Griffin and Rizzo owned this property, they also owned these three other lots, not the first one, but the next three ones. Before they sold the property, they actually created an easement over the back side of those three properties for parking purposes. And then when they deeded out each of those three lots, they retained the right to use parking spaces behind there. If you were to go in there, you'll see there's 13 parking spaces.
Okay.
As part of that deal, however, they also conveyed when they conveyed the lots, they gave the owners the right to use over their property to access the passageway. And so key to that is the fact that this garage will not interfere with that passageway. That will continue to remain open after the.
All right, thank you. Yeah, I was kind of confused, but that story explains that pretty well. Okay, thank you.
Now, unfortunately, I actually have a plan that lays this all out. For reasons that aren't clear, it was never recorded.
All right, any final questions? All right, thank you very much. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Out of formality, I will open the public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to speak to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, Close the public hearing. All right. Last application of the night. Of the year. I know. Who wants the honor of making a motion for the last application of the year? Maybe somebody who's been silent so far tonight.
Well, that would be me.
That'd be you.
So I will make a motion to approve.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
I'll give it to Mr. Johnson. Sorry. You're
okay.
Just
that's fair.
Smidge behind. Mr. Fumello, go ahead. Your motion, please.
Okay. So, you know, I think this is a pretty self-explanatory request. And, you know, one thing I would note before even starting is that it is a use variance, but for residential use on the first floor, because it would be allowed on an upper floor. So with that, I'll go into the criteria. This request will not be contrary to the public interest, and the spirit of the ordinance would be observed. I think allowing a residential use on the first floor really doesn't alter the essential character of the neighborhood. As the applicant's attorney mentioned, it's right on the edge of the downtown overlay district, and there are residential uses right nearby. And it looks like a residential use. So having a residential use in there on the first floor and throughout the whole building will actually make more sense to someone who is just driving by. And no evidence that it would threaten the health, safety, or general welfare of the public. Substantial justice would be done. The applicant would, you know, there would be a loss to the applicant if we didn't grant the variance. They wouldn't be able to use the property as a residence, as a single-family home, the way they would like. And there's really no gain to the public that would outweigh that loss. So substantial justice would be done by granting the variance. The values of the surrounding properties, I don't think, would be diminished. There's no evidence to suggest that, and no reason to think that they would. And then there are certainly special conditions, I think, of this property that distinguish it from other properties in the area. As already mentioned, it's on the edge of the downtown overlay district. It also was originally built as a single-family home. I think it is particularly interesting that they had to get a variance, you know, years ago just to use it as commercial, and now they're getting a variance to go back. So we're kind of restoring it to the original purpose of the property. And because of that and the fact that it's on the edge of the district, there's no real substantial relationship between the purpose of kind of this use limitation, which is to maintain economic vitality of the area, since we're really just restoring it back to its original purpose. I think in this unique instance, allowing a residential use where commercial, the ordinance intends a commercial use to be, does not go against the purpose of the ordinance. And the proposed use, I think, is reasonable for, again, the reason that we're restoring it back to its original purpose. So for all those reasons, I would move we approve.
Okay, thank you. Your second, please.
I agree with all that Mr. Formilla had to say. I think it's important for us to recognize, especially with overlay zones like the downtown overlay. I find myself oftentimes making an argument from the other side that we need to recognize that there really are sort of transition buffer zones when we have hard-lined gerrymandered, especially if you've ever really looked at what the downtown overlay zone is. It's like it's about the same, has the same perimeter as this property. And I just think it's important for us to recognize that, you know, that it really isn't a tangible line. It's not a hard line. There are properties that are go both ways on either side of that downtown overlay. And I think that this, full disclosure, this is probably my least favorite house in all of Portsmouth. I have an aversion to Tudor style architecture, and when I walk down the street, I actually cross the street, so I don't even have to, so I don't have to look at it. But I think this is a perfect application for perfect place for this use for all the reasons that Mr. Formilla stated.
You know, like half timbered siding, yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Comments on the motion? I'll just say I will be supporting the motion. I guess the one other aspect that just to touch on quickly is the new addition with the garage. I think is a pretty modest addition. Yeah, there's a very tight setback there, but as the applicant has pointed out, it's over a very short distance. I don't think it affects light and air at all. I think it's still in that little small area, still, you know, enough access to be able to get in there to do maintenance and on the addition. So I don't see it as a major issue. So with that, I'll move to a vote. The motion is to approve. Mr. McDonald.
Yes.
Mr. Parrott.
Yes.
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Mr. Formilla.
Yes.
Mr. Hageman.
Yes.
And the chair votes yes, you are approved.
Thanks very much. Thanks for being the last case of the year.
Yeah. All right, so with that, do we have the final motion of the year? Mr. Parrott, why don't you make our final motion of the year?
Oh, my pleasure, Mr. Chairman. Move that we adjourn for the calendar year 2008.
All right, excellent. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye as well. We are adjourned.